Good morning, everybody. Thanks so much to join this webinar. I'm Domenico Fabio Masi, Marketing Manager for Teletimia. Today we are presenting TeleGNSS portfolio and solution. And I would like to introduce you today. Our presenter is Eric Lagorce, Senior Product Manager for IoT non-cellular product. For your information, a recorded version of this webinar will be available and shared with you. If you have any question during the presentation, please type them into the question box in your control panel. We'll have time for the question at the end of this webinar. Eric, feel free to start when you want. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. So let's go to the first slide, just to explain that Telit is driving the positioning for a long time. We have people skill and working, you know, that spend more than 20 years in GPS, GNSS development. So now, you know, the things are moving. New GNSS constellation. So we start from the GPS and then GLONASS, Galileo. New governmental rule. I will show later our new product, which is compliant with India NAVIC regulation, and also evolution of the different market requirement. So there is not a unique solution to satisfy the different requirement or the different vertical segment. So that's why, in order to provide the best solution for every segment, we are using three different chipset vendor. So we are using ST. So ST is a very good platform, high-end platform, best in accuracy, navigation, in timing. And but the drawback is the power consumption. So it's very high end for the accuracy, but the consumption is not the best as compared to Qualcomm or MediaTek. So in terms of product, we have three main product on the 869 form factor, which is the SL869V3. The SL869 automotive dead reckoning, and the new product, which is the SL869T3i, which is a dual frequency GPS plus NAVIC. Second platform is the Qualcomm platform. So the Qualcomm platform has a big advantage that it's a 1.8 power supply, very good consumption, and also extremely good low power consumption mode. So the best in terms of sensitivity and good GNSS engine, accuracy and timing. So on this family, we have two products without antenna, SC868V3 and SC873Q5, and one product on with integrated antenna. The latest platform is the MediaTek platform. So MediaTek platform, the advantage is the power consumption form. So on the GPS mode, which is the 3337 and the 3333, which is a GPS plus GNSS. It's a GNSS chipset. So clearly the best in consumption, low power, not the best in terms of sensitivity, accuracy compared to the other platform. So in this, with this platform, we have a different set of module in different form factor. So we have in 869 form factor, GPS or GNSS, in 871 form factor, GPS or GNSS, and we have also two form factor with integrated antenna, and still the same approach with GPS or GNSS. Main advantage of the MediaTek platform that you can switch from a GPS chipset to a GNSS chipset pin-to-pin compatible. So at the end, you can swap one module to the other. GPS GNSS module portfolio. So as I said, different chipset core feature, different form factor with or without antenna. So without antenna, we have four different form factor. So the 7x7, which is a GNSS Qualcomm base, 9.7x10.1, which is the 871 form factor, which is GPS or GNSS MediaTek base. So you have four product, GPS or GNSS with or without additional internal LNA. We have the 11x11 platform, which is the 868 form factor, which is GNSS only and based on Qualcomm, and the latest form factor, which is the SL869 form factor, 16x12.2, which is GPS or GNSS, and as I show the slide before, based or on ST or in MediaTek. After that, we have a set of module with integrated antenna. So same approach, GPS, GNSS based on MediaTek for the 868 form factor. 876 form factor is Qualcomm base. The latest we release in mass production is the 878 form factor, which is based on MediaTek. The latest product, the SC872, is also MediaTek-based GNSS, but also with a connector embedded. Something important in terms of form factor and compatibility. Okay, so we have, as I said, on the 871 form factor, we have GPS or GNSS with integrated or without LNA. So in terms of compatibility for design, moving to one design to another design, the product user guide is the reference document. So you have everything to start your design, considering that you want to switch from a GPS to a GNSS module. Same approach for the 11x11, the 868 family. First product we released years ago was the GF2, which is a GPS only Qualcomm base, to the latest Qualcomm chipset GNSS. So the product user guide is also the reference document to see the communality and the difference. And the latest form factor, which is the 16x12x12, which is the 869 family. So the first product was the Gen3 Qualcomm base, up to the latest generation or V3 TZO 3 base, which is ST, or the 869 V2 MediaTek base. So the product user guides of the latest module are the reference document for the compatibility in your design. What's new? So let's move to the latest product. So which are the new antenna module 878. We introduce also the new NAVIC module. And I want also to highlight all the Telit proprietary NMEA interface and command that we introduce in mass production for next year. So the new antenna module, which is the 878, come to extend our portfolio. So we already have the 868 with integrated antenna MediaTek base, which is with a directive antenna 9x9. So ideal for small thin application and wearable. We have also the 876 Q5, which is 11x11 with an omnidirectional antenna. So same ideal for small thin application and wearable, and embed also RF switch for external antenna. And we introduce now a bigger module with a bigger antenna, which is a MediaTek base, so in GPS or GNSS, and you have a directed antenna with higher performances, so which is ideal for standard tracking boxes and with embedded RF switch for external antenna. So in terms of differences, Q3 is the GNSS part and Q7 is the GPS only. So the main difference will be that one is a flash memory base, which is the GNSS, and the ROM variant, which is the GPS. So we have for both the antenna on and the antenna on, we have the antenna open short sensing. I will explain later this MediaTek feature, which is available only on the GNSS side. So the new NAVIC module, which is called the SL8693E. So what is it? It's a multiband receiver that support L1 for GPS and L5 for NAVIC. 869 form factor. So the module comply with the automotive industry standard 140. And this automotive industry standard must be used for all the vehicle location tracking device in public transportation vehicle, starting in April next year in India. So this is mandatory feature. So the SLA693 is based on TZO3 plus additional chip to manage concurrently the two frequency. So the supply voltage range is between 3 and 3.6 volt. So industrial temperature, and more or less you find all the features supported by TZO3. So now we are in, we already deliver marketing sample. We are in engineering phase. So product will be available end of December, first week of January, and we start the mass production in end of January to deliver our customer to be ready on time for April 2019. So now let's move to the TeleGNSS software architecture. So we use the vendor hardware, which is based on the Qualcomm MediaTek or ST Micro. All the vendor provide also the SDK, so all the software API. On top of this, we put a teletranslation layer in order to provide also module feature, which are antenna management, detection, sensing, LNA, GNSS constellation configuration, low power management, geofencing, etc. On top of this, we integrate PTWS interface, which is the Telit proprietary NMEA interface. So, Telit NMEA interface, it's comply with the 0183 standard. It's input command and output message. It's cross-vendor availability. So we will introduce on all flash-based module. So mainly GNSS module, Qualcomm and MediaTek. So new feature and enhanced capability exposure. And the Telit proprietary NMEA interface, we have some of the commands are already available on the latest mass production firmware for all the Qualcomm and MediaTek product that we release during this summer or September timeframe. And we will have a full availability on mass production for the next release, the maintenance release for the Qualcomm and MediaTek product on Q1 2019. Geofencing, we have already a beta version for the Qualcomm module, and we will have a full availability on mass production for Qualcomm module in Q1 2019. So, as a not the complete exhaustive list, but let's focus on some of the features. So with this command, you will have the Telit software version, antenna detection, LNA gain management. You will have NMEA RLM message, module reset, baud rate, position data message, velocity data message, GNSS time data message. We will also store on non-volatile memory how to manage the low power gain for the Qualcomm and the MediaTek. An auto baud rate detection, manage also the low gain, high gain on Qualcomm, and save also all the navigation parameters to the non-volatile memory. We will introduce also the RLM for search and rescue, an external MEM detection port, and in the Telit geofencing management, we will improve and add also the periodic status reporting, GPIO to signal an event, and polygon fence. And the latest, we will do also improvement on the odometer feature supported on the MediaTek platform. Now, if we go on the Qualcomm module feature, so it's a GNSS only based on Qualcomm Star 5, 1.8 working voltage, 75 milliwatt in tracking on GNSS, very good navigation accuracy, GPS GLONASS Beidou Galileo supported, so NMEA Telit command geofencing, best RF sensitivity among the Telit portfolio. Client ephemeride 3 days and server ephemeride up to 14 days. So we support UART I2C SPI, and we have advanced power mode with still good accuracy. So this is a target market. It's a low-end telematic, and it's the best balance versus power and accuracy. So on the Qualcomm base module, we have two low power modes. First one called the Smart GNSS One mode, SG1. It's an adaptive mechanism based on satellite signal strength to reduce the number of tracked satellites. The criteria is to enter and remain in SG1 is a valid position fix with 6 or more satellites above 26 dB Hz. Otherwise, the receiver switch to full power mode. So in a way, the SG1 algorithm is cutting the weakest channel and it's try to keep always on GPS. Second low power mode, what they call high power reduction mode, HPR. So it works at a different update rate, where the chipset is automatically able to switch between this mode and full power, depending on the latest condition of the module. So it's applicable on the 873Q5, 868V3, and the SL876Q5 with integrated antenna. And there is a dedicated document in our website available for this different mode. So if we compare the full power mode to the SG1, there is only minimal difference in the accuracy between smart GNSS and full power mode tracking. SG1 is a reliable low power solution that can be selected when accuracy is to be prioritized, but a consumption reduction is also needed. So this is more or less example and live and test did by the application engineering. So we can save more or less 25 to 30% consumption reduction, and you will see that there is some minor difference versus the full power. Full power versus high power reduction mode. So HPR is a duty cycle mode, so it's different. Accuracy is comparable to full power mode, but only when you have a good RF condition. So it degrades further for difficult environment. This mode presents the best trade-off between the evaluated solution achieving the largest power saving result with an acceptable degradation of the accuracy performance. For sure, this mode, you can see that you have a 16 meter offset, but you can also make it an imbalance, but you can save up to 75% consumption. So for sure, it's not for all the use cases, but for some use cases, this HPR mode, it's very, very convenient. If we do a comparison, we can note that the HG1 has a power reduction of 28%, sorry. While in HPR mode, you can decrease by 76% compared to the full power mode. So this is the table of the Qualcomm GNSS module. So in full power, you have 75 milliwatt consumption, and you see that on the smart GNSS, you reduce to 54, while for different settings, you can put for the high power reduction mode, you can go down to 2.7 milliwatt. Let's move now to the MediaTek module feature. Okay, so MediaTek is the best in terms of consumption on GPS side and GNSS. So it's the target market is low-end telematic, but 3-volt base. So two chipset, 33 GNSS, 37 GPS only. So this is the voltage range, 3 to 4.3 volt. In terms of consumption, 44 to 54 with or without integrated LNA on GPS mode to maximum 75 milliwatt on GNSS with integrated LNA. So in with the 33, we four constellation, GPS, GLONASS, Galileo, and Beidou. We implement also all the Telit NMEA command, UART, I2C, SPI. I2C is not support on the GPS only. So same as Qualcomm, there is some low power mode, so low power consumption and duty cycle mode for low power, antenna sense and odometer feature. So two low power mode. First one that they call the GLP mode, it consists of a sub-second duty cycle, reducing the time the module is working in full power without reducing the update rate in the continuous mode. Second mode, which is a periodic mode, user can set the device to alternate between normal mode, on, standby, or backup mode. As for the Qualcomm platform, we have a dedicated user guide that explains the different low power mode and how to set these different modules, which is the SL871 GPS, GNSS, and also 869 form factor, and the 868 or 878 module based with the GNSS with integrated antenna. Let's make some tests. So the GLP versus the full powered in driving mode. So as you can see, the device show 15-18 meter offset in GLP mode compared to full power. There is a sort of delay response to heading variation. And in this power saving means less accuracy, but we are in driving mode. If you do the same comparison, but on a walking mode, for a slow mover like a personal tracker, pet tracker, the accuracy of the GLP match the full power. Power reduction is more or less 50%, and the accuracy is almost the same. Okay, so as a as an example, you can see that the current consumption with a GLP is an average of 13.5, while in a normal mode you have you are at 23.4 milliamp. Periodic mode versus full power. So low power consumption, we did the test for a UBI tracking device. So we set periodic mode with 5 to 30 seconds and 10 second, 30 second setting were tested. So you can see that the best trade-off between updated rate and accuracy is achieved for the first setting, which is 5 seconds on and 30 seconds sleep, whereas the second setting does not allow to have a good tracking. So if we do the low power mode comparison, the table below compare the power consumption in milliwatts. So in full power, we are at minus 70 milliwatts. If we implement the GNSS low power, we go down to 30 and we can go down to 6 milliwatts with a 10 second full power and 30 second sleep. As I said, the periodic mode can be used for ultra low power, but 5 seconds on, 30 seconds off is the suggested period to be able to really track the application. So in this case, we are more or less at 14 milliwatts. Another interesting feature, the odometer feature. So we did several tests, bicycle or running or walking. And as you can see, the accuracy is pretty good when you walk on run. And there is only an offset of below 2% when you are using a bicycle. Other interesting feature on the MediaTek GNSS base is the antenna detection. So we use two GPIO and some external additional component to be able to detect antenna open or short circuit. So latest platform, which is the ST platform. So based on the T03 GNSS, so the chipset is automotive qualified. So higher consumption, so between 130 and 180 milliwatt at 3.3 volt, but it's the best navigation accuracy. We have UART I2C, USB and CAN bus. We implement also the dead reckoning. We have the SL869 ADR with integrated six-axis MEMS. We implement also a new software feature, which is the sensor over UART. And it's the best multipass mitigation in urban canyon. So target market is more high-end telematic or automotive solution. So let's move to some explanation on the classic automotive dead reckoning. So automotive dead reckoning refers the capability of the GNSS to continue to navigate in automotive platform when there is an insufficient number of GNSS satellite available or there is no satellite. So the receiver uses information provided by the external sensor concerning the state of the vehicle in order to propagate the navigation solution. And the automotive dead reckoning feature can combine vehicle state of information with the GNSS solution in order to provide improved navigation. So without dead reckoning, when you are enter a new tunnel or you don't have any GPS coverage, in a way you are lost, while with implementing the dead reckoning navigation, you have still the position. So the classic automotive dead reckoning, so you need several data. So data from the accelerometer, the gyroscope for the attitude, the speed and distance, and also the direction. So the Pro is very precise, but require connecting the DR unit in the car in order to access to the odometer and forward reverse information. So CAN bus will tick pulse. Cons, that speed and direction data may be not present in every car or easy accessible in the same location. Okay. So to overcome with the SL869 ADR, we implement into the module all the sensor to overcome this situation. So now we also we move from the wheel tick sensor over the heart. So what is the evolution? The evolution, you have a system with the SL69, you have the accelerometer, the gyro, and you have access to the power supply, the reverse, the ground, and the wheel ticks, which is hardwire. Sensor over your heart is what? You still have the 12 volt and the and then you get through the CAN bus all the data processed to the customer microcontroller that push through UART the speed and the reverse message. Okay. So this new feature in terms of software, we call it sensor over UART. So how does it work? The host platform is connected to the vehicle CAN bus sensor. The platform processor receives CAN sensor message, decode the message data and retransmit the data on the UART as NMEA message. So command will tick count reverse. And the SL869 the automotive DR plus the sensor over UART firmware consume sensor message and provide the navigation, so the position, the velocity, and the time. So this is implemented both solution automotive DR and sensor over UART into the SL869 ADR module. So assisted GPS, what does it do? So first, time to fix is the amount of time the receiver needs in order to calculate a valid position. So the TTFF depends on the initial status of the receiver. So or you are in cold start and you need time and the broadcast ephemeris to be decoded, or you are in warm start, so time is valid but still be has to be decoded, or you are on hot start and you have both are valid, time and broadcast ephemeris. A GPS is a system that often significantly improves the time to fix performance. And the GPS is a pre-calculated synthetic ephemeris into a file to be injected into the GNSS receiver in order to reduce the time to first fix. Advantage, shorten the time to first fix, and for sure, reduce the total power consumption, which is the most critical. A GPS capability chart on the three platform. So in autonomous mode, Qualcomm, MediaTek, and ST, it's up to 3 days, except for the GPS on MediaTek, which is only 1 day because it's a ROM variant. With a server assisted, up to 14 days for Qualcomm, 30 days to MediaTek, and up to 7 days for ST. In terms of distribution server, so you have the address of to access to the Qualcomm, MediaTek, or ST on the Telit.com, and Telit offers a GPS server data usage for free. Telit Global Technical Support. Technical support is executed by dedicated Telit Engineering Department. Global Technical Support is divided by geographical areas. So this is the different address on this. So each time you route, you get a ticket and you can start the discussion with the with the with the TEDx team, and they will answer, I will say, within one day to most of your questions. Design review services. TEDx is offering a complete design review services executed by dedicated TEDx engineering that are part of the application engineering on R&D department. So schematic review, PCB layout review, component placement advice, component selection, filtering, antenna matching. When the design review is completed, the technical support send a report with all the TEDx suggestion and correction of the design. And if any additional investigation is required, technical support will contact the customer and will update him about the outgoing activity. As a summary of the TEDx GPS portfolio, so I keep on the old GF2 and GN3 Qualcomm base. And most of the products recommended for new design are based on MediaTek, based on the two form factor 871 and 869 for without antenna and with integrated antenna on the 868 and the 878 form factor. In terms of GNSS portfolio summary, we have Qualcomm, MediaTek, and ST. So, Qualcomm, we have one module with an integrated antenna, and we have a different set of module for MediaTek and different form factor. While ST is only the SLH69V3. So on this table, I didn't put the automotive data reconning, neither the Navic India module. So, what is the best solution? Some question before choosing the solution. You know, what is the use case? What is the voltage? Accuracy? Is it a portable or fixed installation? Is there any governmental constraint? And I need to make decision. Sorry. I need to make decision on the, you know, what is the most important. Do I need RF sensitivity or consumption or first time to fix? So we have a real good application engineering team and technical support team and also sales specialists. So in this case, ask for a TEDx expert opinion. We can support you. That's all.
Thank you, Eric. For the moment, we don't have any questions.
Okay.
So we'll wait a second if something came up. No, so we don't have any for today. So thank you, everybody. It was a pleasure being with you today. Thank you, Eric, for your webinar. And as you know, this is the last one of this series, and we hope to start again next year. Thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you. Bye-bye.